Okay, so this talk is about my experience over the past 8 months developing a desktop application for one of our clients in Electron. First of all, I'm going to tell you who I am. I have been a software developer for 35 years. I count all the way back to when I was 5 and playing with the TI. 99 4A, my dad bought me. Only professionally for 20. They have these things called child labor laws, which unfortunately I have to deal with. I am very passionate about Unix and network software development. I have memories of wiring up my parents' basement, first with serial lines and later with Ethernet, just so I could keep the noisy computer in another room and have a little terminal in my bedroom for me to chat long into the night online. I may or may not have built my own DNS and TFTP stacks from scratch at various times for no good reason other than I could. And currently I'm a software consultant and developer in Ann Arbor, working at Atomic Object. We're a consultancy. We create custom software products, web, mobile, embedded development. If you have a project you'd like some development help on, give us a look up and we'll be happy to talk to you. So what I'm going to talk about today are several points about this project I alluded to and how Electron made this project really work for us and how we made Electron really work for our project. I'm going to start just telling you guys what Electron is. I'm going to talk a little bit about what we built, what kind of project it is, and how Electron helped us out there. Delivering an application, how we actually go from a pile of JavaScript to an installer that we can ship to our customers, how to debug the mess of code that we just produced, and a little bit about performance too. I know Electron applications are notorious for using up a lot of memory and CPU, and I'll tell you a little bit how we addressed that when we started having some problems. And finally, just kind of cover a little bit about should you choose Electron for your project. All right, what it is. Electron is a Node.js framework that leverages Chromium, which is the web browser engine that's in Google Chrome, to create desktop user interfaces using web technologies. Basically what that means is you are writing a program in Node.js that's going to run on your desktop machine, and your front end for it is going to be not in the user's web browser, but in a window that's powered by the same engine that powers Google Chrome. One of the really, really important things to understand is Electron app is a Node.js app. That means it's JavaScript all the way down, all the way from your web interface all the way down to the code that's running headless in there. It's not a thin wrapper around Chrome. It's actually more like Node implemented into a Chrome browser, which gives it more capabilities than you would get inside a normal browser. The architecture that you'll be working with is you start off with what's called the main process. This is a headless process. It has no user interface. It is the first program that runs, and then it can spawn any number of renderer processes, which are basically windows inside your application. Each one of those windows is like a web application. It contains a web application. Each one of these runs its own JavaScript thread. And each one can communicate back to the main process using an inter-process communications channel. And that I'll talk more about that channel in a minute. This is an example of the JavaScript code. Yeah.
So would a renderer like roughly correspond to the global window object inside?
Yep. And in fact, this example right here is of us spawning one of them. So this code runs in the main process, and you create a browser window, and then inside that browser window there is going to be a window object inside that. And each one is separate. So they are running independently. And the main process doesn't have a window object because it's headless. It's running Node, but it does have global space as well. But they're separate processes with separate memory space, and they communicate with these IPC messages. But this is literally all you need to do to launch that first renderer. Okay, there's a little more setup which isn't on this slide. But there's plenty of, there's a quick start guide on the Electron main site which explains it in a little more detail. But this is the code that actually spawns that window. Path.join just tells it, hey, we're looking for an index.html. That's going to be the root of our web application. Electron IPC, I've kind of mentioned a couple times here. This is the main way you're going to communicate between kind of the guts of your program and its user interface. There's two node modules that are responsible for this. They're called IPC main and IPC renderer, depending on which one you're importing it into. I don't know if anybody's familiar with the event emitter pattern, but basically what it is you register a listener for an event channel. You name any channel you want, it's just an arbitrary string. So I'll show you an example in just a second. And then on the other end, you can send anything that you can fit into JSON, can go over this IPC channel. So you're pretty much free to do whatever you want. Once you send it from one end, either from the renderer to the main process, or from the main process back to the renderer, it will be picked up by the event listener on the other side. This is an example of the HTML that you can load into a renderer window. One of the really interesting things here, inside those script tags there, that's node code, and it is JavaScript, but it's got a few different capabilities than you might find in your browser. In particular, the require statement is how you import a JavaScript module, which module systems I don't believe are actually in any browsers right now, because they're still sorting out how to do those. When we ship a web application, we use tools that bundle them all up into one JavaScript file, rather than try to import modules. So, and the other important thing to notice here is that inside this, unlike inside a web application, you do have access to all the Node.js APIs, so you can use the file system, you can use network, you can use whatever Node would let you do, which is pretty much anything you can do in most interpreted languages. That said, I don't advise it. And there's some really good interesting reasons for that, which I'll kind of touch on in a minute here. Let me talk about what we built here. This is what I've been building for the better part of the year. I've been tech leading this project. In the beginning of the year, we decided to make a recommendation to proceed with Electron instead of some of the other desktop technologies. But what they wanted us to build was an instructor station that controls driving simulators. Now, we're not doing the driving simulation on our application at all. What we're doing is we're receiving messages using some just really low-level TCP UDP protocols. Sorry? Oh, I thought I saw it.
No, okay, no,
sorry. Okay. And we're translating them into IPC messages that can be displayed in the front end. And then the idea is that an instructor will sit down at this instructor station and will be able to start the simulation, pause it, rewind it, show them what they did wrong, that sort of thing. Another one of its requirements is that it needs to initialize the simulation, and it needs to read and copy and write a bunch of configuration files and data into a network share that these simulators are going to read. So that's another. And then finally, there's a few things we don't have in our application that are already implemented. They're available as like external processes on the desktop system. So our application also will need to launch and manage some external processes as well. In order to do anything in JavaScript, you really need to embrace asynchronous programming, meaning you're going to set up a listener when something's done and give it a function that's going to be called back when that thing has happened. This is particularly important because Node.js and Electron do not support threads at all. Each one of those processes is its own execution, and it's only going to be able to deal with the outside world and other processes and other tasks with asynchronous programming. So if you want to keep your application responsive and not have it hang up waiting for something to happen and frustrating your users, you need to be as asynchronous as possible. This is an important lesson we learned. We did a Node.js server project before this, and there were some really computation heavy things going on there. And one thing we ran into was when some of those computations got really heavy duty, they would actually just block everybody else and really impact everyone else's experience because the node process was so busy dealing with the work that it couldn't even answer incoming requests on the web. So that's a very important thing to realize, is you never want to load your node process down with too much computation. Node has a lot of APIs to deal with everything, all of our requirements here. We use core Node APIs for most stuff. For networking, we use the Socket and DGRAM modules that came with Node. Socket handles TCP, DGRAM handles UDP. File I/O, they have the FS module. This is probably a very unique experience for anybody who's done I/O in any synchronous language, because you actually say, I want a file, and then you give it a callback to say, when it's open, let me know, which is something that an experience you typically get in the synchronous language. But this keeps everything really responsive, because even opening a file is a process that takes a little bit of time. It's all non-blocking. To launch those external processes, there's another Node.js module in there called process. We also had a really fun, unique requirement on this on Windows. We actually have to access some Microsoft Access databases. Mm-hmm. Yeah. This one was so important, we checked to see whether we could do it before we made a recommendation. But there is a module out there in the wide world of JavaScript that lets you open an Access database and give it SQL queries and get stuff back. So, yeah. And it works. It only works on Windows, of course. So
Electron works on
Linux
and Windows?
Yeah. Yep. Yep. You can ship it anywhere. The supported platforms are... there's four different Linux variants, and then Windows and Mac OS. We're just delivering the Windows application, but we had such a good experience where we can just develop on Mac and not worry about it and just do integration testing every so often.
Right.
Yeah. Obviously, we can't test the Access database. Thankfully, that was a fairly small part of the project.
What do you use instead of the Access database on the other platform?
We have just a mocked up thing that will respond. If you're running on Mac OS, it's going to pretend there's a database there and just answer certain queries a certain way. And it's good enough for development, and then we test it with the real database before we ship the feature. Another interesting detail we had is we only have one of these driving simulators in our office and a couple developers working on it. And plus, sometimes I like to work from my recliner at home, and I definitely don't have a driving simulator in my house. So we have a little side program that actually pretends to be a simulator, also written in JavaScript. It's much smaller, much more hacky, but it sends all the packets back and forth that a real simulator would, within reason. And it's definitely good enough to to test some new features out in the desktop application. I mentioned earlier having to do a lot of asynchronous programming. JavaScript recently gained async await, which makes asynchronous processing a lot easier. It's written a lot closer to synchronous style, so you can say let x equals await and give it an asynchronous function. And that function's execution will just pause until the value is ready. And in the meantime, the remainder of the program can execute. So, we wrote some wrappers around some of these older APIs so we could use that style of programming to make everything work a lot better for us. As far as our architecture, this is a single window application, so we only spawn one. We only are working with one renderer process. This also makes things a lot simpler as far as deciding where to send IPC messages, because we just have one reference to the renderer process inside the main process there. And as I alluded to earlier, you can use those APIs, those file system APIs, those network APIs, inside your render process if you want to. But especially after the poor experience we had on the Node.js application and heavy computation, I thought it'd be really a good idea to keep the main process responsible for all these things, even if they're asynchronous, just to keep as much load off of the renderer as we can and make sure the renderer is able to provide that smooth user experience without hanging up. Because that's incredibly frustrating when you're in a web application. I'm sure just about everybody's had it, where you go to try to click something and it's just absolutely not responding. Nothing's animating, nothing's happening. And that's even before it goes to the server. Sometimes JavaScript gets stuck in a loop because, some bug or something like that. We didn't want that to happen. So we made sure that there was nothing else going on inside that renderer process. When the renderer process wants to do something, it sends a request over to the main process. Over the IPC channel. The main process handles it and sends that and also events back, like, hey, a simulator was connected, or the current time simulation is 10 seconds. This is actually really like server and browser, to the point that we called the main process a server for like 2 or 3 months until we finally got the terminology down. So, to talk a little bit about how we plumbed this thing. I'm going to I don't know if anybody's used React Redux in here. It's a good thing I have this slide. React Redux is a JavaScript framework that renders, it's basically functional. It renders your entire user interface based on a big tree of state that's in your application. And you're not allowed to modify that tree except by sending little JSON objects that say something like, like I alluded to earlier, like this simulator is connected, or the time bar is at 10 seconds, or I've gone into replay mode. These are little teeny little messages that come in. They're absorbed by the Redux framework, and that causes that change to change our state, and then that bubbles down to our components. It looks something like this. We have our main process up top. That's the one that's dealing with network access, file I/O, all that stuff. And then inside the render process, we first started out by building kind of a client library, because I was thinking, I don't want to tie too closely our IPC messages and our user interface. So what we started to do is hook up all sorts of request lines and all sorts of response lines, and then the response lines would translate into actions that would change the user interface. This got messy really fast because we were tracking so many of these. I have only 5 lines there, but I think once we realized this was going to be untenable, we probably had a good 20 of them. And some of them also would tear themselves down and bring themselves back up. It became very hard to debug. This is kind of what it looks like to hook those things up. The main process would send a message to the renderer. It had a reference to the renderer it could send. It said, hey, device is connected. Device window is disconnected. And then the renderer process would be listening for that. The once is a listener, a special kind of listener that tears itself down once it's fired. That dispatch call right there is what fed that second action into the Redux framework to actually update our user interface. But this, like I said, this got messy really, really fast. We realized that those IPC messages and those Redux actions, they're all like JSON-y objects, and we're inventing them as we go anyway, so why don't we just unify them? This was a dramatic savings in the complexity of our app. We only have two IPC channels now. One goes from the main process to the renderer, it's called action, and it carries Redux actions like this one up here. That's the same one we just saw in this previous slide. Only we're having the main process just send it now. And that's our protocol for communicating between the two things. And the render process just listens. It doesn't even look into it. It just listens for actions and it feeds them right into the Redux framework. So now it looks a lot more like this. And it's way, 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 way easier to deal with. And in fact, we even got rid of the client because we didn't need it anymore. There is one really, really cool thing which we just started a week and a half ago, which I knew was possible because I did an early experiment, but the client didn't ask for it until a week and a half ago, and they said, we have a week and a half to make it. Is that we could actually attach a web browser with its own React Redux application and wire it up like this. And all the actions just get copied to everybody, and they interpret them in their own way, because this has a different user interface in this web browser. But then it sends requests. But let's say like we send a request to start a simulation. The desktop app doesn't care that that request was sent, but it starts to receive events from the main process. It says a simulation started. The simulation's at 10 seconds, 11 seconds, 12 seconds. And it just updates the user interface. This is what that looks like, and our other web browser is actually a handheld device, so the instructors can walk around and, you know, just look over students' shoulders, pause it, and it's live updated the whole time they're running this. So, you know, they hit the drive button to start the simulation, the clock starts ticking on both the desktop and their handheld. They can also attach as many handhelds as they want. Well, we only test them. Theoretically, there's no limit. I'm sure we'd hit one eventually. But yeah, it's really, really convenient for the instructors because then they are able to, you know, just basically do everything they need to do while walking around and helping students out. So there's a couple of interesting lessons we learned around debugging and performance during this development. We have two processes to deal with here, and you actually debug both of them in completely different ways, which is a little bit frustrating. The main process is a regular Node program, and so our IDE, we use IntelliJ. It's a JetBrains product. It's a pretty good IDE for this kind of stuff. Other people in our organization use some other things as well. But it already knows how to debug a node.js process. We just tell it to look at Electron instead of Node as the binary it's going to debug. We did run into an interesting situation where we had a system out in the field that was exhibiting some strange behavior, and we wanted to attach a debugger to it. It turns out you can run the program with a special inspect flag, and you can then have an instance of Chrome, and it'll give you a URL. You type that URL over into Chrome, and it'll actually attach to your Electron process and let you debug it. So that was incredibly, incredibly handy in the field. So we could kind of peek into this really weird situation we were getting without installing an IDE on their desktop machine, which I'm not even sure my license would let me do that. Debugging a render process is not quite as convenient in one way, but more convenient in another. The Chrome developer tools are just there inside your application. Inside a normal Electron application, they're inaccessible. You don't have a shortcut key or a menu to turn them on like you would inside the Chrome browser. But you do have an API you can call, and we used to, for the first 4 or 5 months, we actually just went ahead and opened the developer tools every time we ran the app, so they were always there. As we came closer to release, we installed a package called Electron Debug, which basically gives us a global hotkey that can be pressed to bring up the debug console and not bother people with it otherwise. So the performance thing hit us probably about halfway through the project. This system is capable of driving several driving simulators at a time. They're all running the same lessons or maybe different lessons. It came after we added the map feature where we could track the position of the student on a map. And we noticed that things are getting really, really laggy. So once we added those maps, we took a look, and the problem was actually here. And this is a little bit kind of deep Redux stuff here, and you don't need to worry about it. But the problem was this map state to props function gets called every time the global app state updates, and it decides whether to re-render that component or not. We were deriving a brand new array of device names on that device names line every time. And so what this component did, and this was a pretty high-level component high up in the tree, said, you need to re-render me and everything underneath me every time the slightest thing changes in the application. And considering we process tens, sometimes 100 updates per second in this application, that was really, really expensive. And it was dragging like you would think. The solution was actually fairly simple in this case. We added a lifecycle method to the Redux component that just used a deep compare instead of a shallow compare. And that was enough to patch this over. We also looked at some other instances where we were creating these kind of problems and just changed the way our properties were coming out so that it didn't trigger that problem all the time. But that was enough to get everything back up off the ground, and it's back to, you know, handling these 100 updates per second live across several different things. And we've added some new features since and reapplied some of these lessons again. But that's all Redux, and why am I talking about Redux when I'm talking about Electron, right? The reason is performance problems in Electron applications are JavaScript. There's nothing special about Electron that makes something go slow. You really need to understand your JavaScript. Your user interface must be something that's going to run well inside a browser, and your backend work, it needs to be asynchronous friendly, like all those async APIs we're using. They're not going to get hung up, you know, processing things. If you want to solve performance problems in a Redux app, you need to understand your framework. It's very, very important. We have lots of expertise in Atomic about React Redux now because we've got a lot of projects going on. We were one of the first ones, but yeah, there's definitely lots of people doing it now, so we have lots of expertise to rely on there. Understanding async programming is another key to making a good Electron application. As I've said several times, if you've got computationally intensive work, you probably should find some place to put it. Whether it's spawning another node process that can handle the work, or something in a different language, or in the cloud, or something like that. You don't want that running inside the main loops of your desktop application. And you know, if all else fails, you can always use the Chrome DevTools to look for hotspots, code that's getting executed a lot if you have a something you just can't find. But those are the most important lessons about making a good performant Electron application. Of note, I just benchmarked our application too. I know there's some Electron apps out there that are kind of notorious for using a lot of RAM. Ours is 300 megabytes, and it goes a little above, and then it garbage collects, and it goes back down. It hovers around 300 at all times. So I think that's pretty good. And we make sure we use a framework that doesn't have memory leaks and doesn't try to do a lot of stuff itself. It's kind of a client, and Electron is really good at building clients. Delivering an application, how we get from this code base to our EXE. We use TypeScript. I don't know if anybody's heard of TypeScript here. It's a Microsoft project. It is, frankly, made me actually think, hey, I could actually stand programming in JavaScript for another couple of years. I spent a couple of years doing JavaScript, and there's a lot of pain points around it. TypeScript gives you basically a static type analysis phase when you're translating TypeScript to the JavaScript that's eventually going to run. You go ahead and put strong types on everything so you know what you're receiving into any of your functions is exactly what you expected. It also does some transpilation, which basically means it's going to translate one language into another. It gives you several modern JavaScript features that make working in JavaScript much more pleasant. And then we'll actually down-compile them to a lower level of JavaScript that can run in an Electron app on the node process, or if you're happening to be deploying to a browser using TypeScript, it can go to an even lower level than that for you. Running an Electron app, once TypeScript goes over your TypeScript files, it'll create an out directory, at least in our configuration. You just run electron /main.js, and your program takes over from there. Really easy to run. Webpack is a tool we use a lot for distributing web applications online. It takes kind of a nice structured program with lots of modules and different files all over the place and turns them into one big unreadable blob of JavaScript that's better for the browsers. It's not required here because Electron doesn't either. It will, since it's running Node, it can use all your modules and you can leave your code nicely structured in a tree that makes sense. We use a package called Electron Builder to actually build installers for Windows. It also supports making Linux installers, I believe, certain packaging formats, although I don't recall exactly. On Mac OS, it can build you a disk image and installer as well. For actually doing our builds, we subscribe to a service called AppVeyor, or the client does, I should say. This is a Windows-based continuous integration service, but every time we make a commit to our master branch, it checks it out, runs our tests, builds the EXE, and puts it up for download for the client to download and test on their systems. That's been really nice for us because we don't have to hand do builds for anybody. In fact, I don't believe we've run Electron Packager ourselves in probably 4 or 5 months. We just always go 10 minutes after we commit something to master, a new build is available here. We just pull it down and run it. We tried a number of other projects in our organization, including the Node process project I was on before. We used a CI service called CircleCI, which runs on Linux. And you can build Linux and Mac OS builds really easily in CircleCI on Linux. But if you want to do Windows builds, you need to install Wine in your CircleCI container, which adds 7 minutes to every one of your builds, and I'm not sure I trust it. So, let's just subscribe to this one instead. It comes recommended from another people who are building Windows builds for there. And you can always run them both in parallel if you actually want to do Linux and macOS builds and Windows builds. So the question after all this is, should you use Electron for your desktop application? Oops, sorry, backed up. A couple of reasons why. The JavaScript community is large and vibrant, and that's where almost everybody's attention is going now. There's so much work. I think Microsoft's kind of recentering themselves on JavaScript. obviously the web cloud companies have a lot of investment in JavaScript, and that's where you're going to find so much helpful Stack Overflow answers instead of some of the really crummy ones you get for some other platforms. It's really, really beneficial to tap into the JavaScript community. If your application is kind of a view on work being done elsewhere, which this one was a great fit for it and made me more confident to recommend Electron to our client, it's kind of a dashboard. It's not really, you know, sitting there crunching numbers or anything like that. But Electron's probably a good choice for you. Particularly if your team has a lot of experience in the web stack. We had our designer, who knows some JavaScript, he actually built our entire user interface for us, whereas normally he'd give us some like designs in some sort of application like Sketch or something, and we'd have to go implement them and do all the CSS ourselves. He did the whole thing for us, and we just broke it up into pieces and put it into React, which was great. And he's currently makes contributions to our project going forward without us having to filter them at all, which is really fantastic. Understanding async programming. I have been an async programming nut for as long as I can remember, so this was definitely my baby. In order to really be successful, I think you do need to at least kind of get a good feel for how that callback-based stuff works. Why not? I think I've kind of touched on it a few times, but if your application is going to be doing a lot of work on the desktop and you don't have a good solution for it, you might not want to consider Electron for this. There are other frameworks that still are good, which can help you with that. But I think for what we were building, and since we didn't have a lot of work to do, the web stack was our best choice and allowed us to deliver a pretty impressive and usable application. And of course, you know, maybe you can offload that work too. That's all I have for you. Any questions?
When running in a detached browser engine, how is there any sort of security like in there, or will it honor any IPC call that comes in on that socket?
Yeah, no. First of all, the IPC is tied to the main process that launches it, so you don't have a risk of more messages coming in from untrusted sources. But because you have the full Node APIs in there, yes, then any browser can import like the file system APIs and start doing something. There is a special tag available in Electron renderers called WebView, which is specifically for pulling in untrusted content. So you get a WebView, you give it a URL, and inside that WebView URL, it's the browser sandbox. So there's no Node APIs available. You can pull in anything you would pull into a web browser. So we did not use that. I thought maybe it might be fun to do it, but in the end, we are running on like enclosed networks. These are never going to be connected to anything. So I'm like, it's probably not worth spending the time to figure out how to wire up the messages. Although we could have probably done it with WebSockets after I did the WebSockets example later.
Electron is free, open source?
Yes. Yep. It's a GitHub project.
Okay.
I don't know if you've heard of the Atom editor.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. It's came from that project.
Oh wow.
Yeah. They called it Atom Shell for a while. It was kind of a component, and then so many people were interested in using it that they spun it off into its own project. Right now, in addition to Atom, the Slack desktop application is an Electron application. Microsoft Visual Studio Code is actually an Electron application built from the ground. It's a new project. It's not the same as the regular Visual Studio project. But that said, it's advancing at a really phenomenal rate, and a lot of our internal projects are using Visual Studio Code, which, frankly, if you had asked me a year ago if that was going to happen, I would have laughed. It's turning out to be something really good. I was just listening this weekend to one of my coworkers talk about how he wants to standardize on it for web applications. And you can do that? Really? We've been paying for an IntelliJ license for the past 6 months. So.
Another question.
Is there a company behind it?
Yeah. GitHub is the one. Is the company behind it?
Yeah.
Aside
from being hosted on GitHub, it's actually
it's actually their project.
Okay, I heard it.
Yeah,
gotcha. Yeah, that's an. Yeah.
So I'm just curious, why would you want a driving simulator? Can you tell us a little bit about the application that you're developing?
This is the guy from Ford.
Yeah.
it's for training different police, fire, bus drivers, those sorts of things. So it's for running specific lessons for those types of students.
So this will be a commercial product that's going to be available?
Yeah, there is. In fact, this is a I don't want to get too into it, but this is a new version of the instructor station for an existing project.
So would you say the demarcation for using Electron versus just using a browser would be the offline capability, or are there other reasons that you would say for using?
Yeah, anytime you need desktop capability. So if you want to pop into a taskbar, if you want to access File.io, arbitrary network protocols. If you don't want to deploy a cloud service to do something for whatever reason, you can wrap that all up in an Electron application. I think it's really just the typical desktop versus cloud and client question. And this was disconnected, so it wasn't.
Yeah.
So this was a new version of the instructor station. What was it replacing, and what were some other technologies that were considered for the instructor station?
It was replacing something written in Visual Basic.
Wait,
Classic. Yeah. I'm kind of surprised it, but we ran it side by side. It still runs on Windows 10. I haven't personally done a lot of desktop development lately, so I relied on a lot of my colleagues. And a number of them had just come off of WPF projects and said, you do not want to go there for various reasons. They're unhappy with the tooling, mostly. And we were a lot, hearing from, because we did kind of, I just gave this presentation at an internal conference this weekend, and they thought our experience with Electron was much better than their experience they had with WPF.
Would this be useful in setting up an interface, a controlling interface, maintenance interface to an embedded system that has been
resourced? To an embedded system?
Did you say? An embedded system is running Linux.
Potentially. I think you'd need to have, as long as that embedded system is speaking some sort of network protocol that Node can understand. The lowest level Node goes to, at least as far as I'm aware, is speaking TCP or UDP over Ethernet, or over a network. So as long as, you wouldn't want to run Electron itself on the embedded system. You'd be wanting to run it on a desktop system that would communicate with it. But I don't think it would fit in an embedded system. Unless that system is capable of running Google Chrome, in which case it's probably a better fit. But it sounds, from the embedded systems I know of, it probably strained them pretty mightily. That's just my guess, though. I'd have to really study it. I mean, there's been some pretty impressive embedded systems out there, too.
One more
curiosity
question.
Sure.
Would if you had no, if you never touched Node, if you learned JavaScript, I mean, how much of a learning curve is it to get your head around it?
That's a good question. I think if you're familiar with any interpreted language, you can at least get off the ground with JavaScript fairly quickly.
No, so for example, if you write JavaScript apps, use a framework and everything,
yeah.
You've only done the front end stuff, you've never done the back end with Node.
So in that case, the blanks you need to fill are simply, have you done any other desktop development in other languages before?
JavaScript the front end and Python for the back end.
Okay. Well, I mean, but you probably used some Python modules that interface. There's similar, different but similar modules in Node that do the same kind of things. A lot of times, the API calls are even called similar things, like unlink to remove file, I believe, is another API. Don't crucify me if I got that. But I think the major difference is that, and this thing you need to kind of get your head around, is when you make just about any call in Node that's not immediately computable, you're going to supply a callback that's going to be called back. And now, there are libraries out there that wrap those in promises, so you can use that async await structure to kind of await the results of that. I think if you've worked in that stack before, you probably don't have that far. Especially because if you're working in the browser, you're already familiar with a web-based program. So going full async is just kind of another layer on top of that. I have some blog posts, which I could give you some links to. Or maybe I can like post them on a mailing list or something later. I wrote a series on how promises work, which are one of the key important things to understand about how to get into async programming, where you're just waiting for something to happen over and over again without holding up your JavaScript process. So I can share those, and that might be good.
Would you say that React made a lot of this possible?
React, I think that it made this architecture work really well, especially if you made that one realization that, hey, we just have an event stream of all kinds of different types of events, and it goes in one pipe. And in addition to, I know I've worked with some other JavaScript frameworks before, and the key with React in this particular application is, yeah, you ask for a few things to happen, but usually you're just listening to a stream of events. You're saying, you know, hey, this timer is ticking up, or this ship is moving around the map. So React was a great fit for that because it is basically wired to just digest a stream of events wherever they come from.
You also mentioned the handheld. I didn't catch if Electron works in the handheld as well.
Oh yeah, as you mentioned, I don't think I fully explained that.
Okay.
But the application that's running inside on the handheld is just running in Safari and my iPhone. And what it does when it boots up is it creates a WebSocket connection back to the actual desktop application, which has a web server listening off of it. And then once that WebSocket connection is made, then it can send requests to the desktop application, and then all the actions are copied over that to consume. So.
Is that using React Native or something else?
Nope, it's just plain old React in the browser. Yeah. I think we've got a lot of React Native experience just here. There's some projects starting.
Yeah. I know a lot of folks are hardly in order to React Native and that. But it's mostly just because it's then you can use the. If you care about like what the widgets look like on your phone.
Capabilities too, because I know things like notifications, for example, it's always my sore point with web applications. That's changing too, so who knows. Yeah.
What resource storage look like? Is most of this stored as just JavaScript and an image and then HTML for your layout?
Yep. Yeah, it looks just like you would upload to a web directory to serve.
So it's just a directory of loose files, or is it like an archive? Or?
Yeah, no, it is a directory. So when we run it with Electron /main.js, we actually, in that out tree is actually what you would, you know, it's got JS in the root, it's got an HTML file which gets loaded by that, and that one references JavaScript files and images and everything in that tree. When we actually package it, the packager will take that and make an archive out of it. Mm-hmm. Although I think we actually disabled that a couple months ago because we wanted to actually serve more files from a web server out of that. So it actually does install a tree of HTML, CSS, SVGs onto the computer.
Yeah. My follow-on question to that was, how do you stop somebody from going in and modifying it outside of
You don't really have a lot of options for that. the packaged one uses a format called ASAR, but it's not encrypted or locked down or anything. There may be ways to do that. We haven't explored it because it's not a requirement. But there may be some ways to do that. The ASAR will make it a little more obscure, but it's not hard to find a tool to open up that ASAR and dig into it.
Are you taking advantage of web browsers, they have like local storage and all that other kinds of taking advantage of any of that stuff, or is that available to you at all?
We're not, because we're driving all of our file I/O and everything through that node process and just using the file system APIs for that. I'm not sure if it's available. It might be available in a web view, but because the renderer process actually runs the node API as opposed to a browser API, there are things, there are a few differences as to what might be available. Especially because there's no HTTP involved, so you can have cookies, for example, you know, that sort of thing. One of these questions actually came up because I brought up that point about being single-threaded and not being able to offload work. And one of my colleagues asked about web workers, which I'm not super familiar with. And I found out you can use them in an Electron process, but you can't use most of the Electron APIs because they're not thread safe.
Wow.
So that's kind of an interesting detail. Maybe they're going to hammer that out more over time. Yeah. Probably other APIs with similar problems were just not available at all.
And that's the problem that basically all integrated languages have. Mm-hmm. Right, and nobody can solve it. But if you look at all Python, JavaScript, Perl, PHP, they all have that issue. That's the advantage of using something like Java or C#, is anything that low-level locking.
I mean, you get that in some interpreted languages, but JavaScript
is pretty limited. Compared to like C or Java.
Well, they try to be a little more fast and looser than JavaScript, though.
Yeah. Well, JavaScript we're going to go single threaded for everything and just be completely callback driven and embrace asynchronous from the beginning. And then things like web workers are a patch on top of that.
Yeah. Well, so are promises as well.
Promises are just a way to wrap callbacks.
Yeah.
But they're still embracing kind of the asynchronous thing. But they are class objects that represent something that will come later. It's I don't, you use Twisted at all?
A little bit here and there. Yeah.
It's Twisted. Yeah. Is promise is the same thing as a defer.
Yeah.
You know. So it represents a value that's going to come back later. But other than that, it's really just wrapping. And in fact, the code to actually translate something that has a callback into a promise is like 4 lines long. I can do it in my C, so many times. Once you have a promise, then you can use async await, which is more syntactic sugar on top of that. But it's syntactic sugar I'm very happy to use because it makes it so much nicer to do it.
Any other questions?
All right. Okay. Thanks, everybody.
Thank you.